My name is Mary Kay Quinlan. I work for Gannett News Service, and I am president of the club this year. I'd like to welcome my fellow club members and their guests in the audience today, as well as those of you who are listening to this program over one of the 303 national public radio stations or watching on one of the 2,300 cable systems affiliated with C-SPAN, the Cable Satellite Public Affairs Network. Before going any further, I would like to remind our members of some coming events. On Wednesday, October 8th, public television personality Alastair Cook will speak about changes in America since his arrival here in 1932. And on Tuesday, October 14th, our luncheon speaker will be Violeta Chamorro, the owner and publisher of La Prensa, the last independent newspaper in Managua, Nicaragua that was closed in June by the Sandinista government. Dr. Robert Gale of the USC School of Medicine will speak to us in early October. Please watch for the date to be announced. His topic will be the short and long-term implications of the Chernobyl incident. I'd like to remind those of you in the audience that if you have any questions for our speaker today, and I trust that you will, please write them on the cards that have been furnished at your tables and pass them up to me. I will ask as many as time allows. I'd like now to introduce our guests at the head table. And I would ask our guests to please stand briefly when their names are read, and I would ask you in the audience to withhold your applause until I have read all the names. First, seated at my far left is Mitch Waldrop with Science Magazine. Next to him is Bob Garfield with Crane Syndicate. On his right is Craig Kovalt with Aviation Week and Space Technology. Seated next to him is Stephen G. Kelman of the San Antonio Light. I would like to offer congratulations publicly to Mr. Kelman. He is this year's recipient of the Baltimore Sun's H.L. Mencken Award, which was presented just before this program started. Next to him is Gil Klein with Media General Newspapers and a member of our Speakers Committee who helped organize today's luncheon. Next to Gil is Ann Drian, novelist, television writer, and producer who co-wrote the Cosmos television series, and she is also the wife of our speaker. I will skip our speaker for the moment. Seated to his right is Randy Allen, the Vice President of Pyramid Video and Chairman of the National Press Club Speakers Committee. Next to Randy is James I. Houck, the Managing Editor of the Baltimore Sun. On his right is Jan Ziegler with United Press International. Next to her is Don Kirkman with Scripps Howard News Service. On his right is Bill Ruberry with the Richmond Times-Dispatch. And at the far end is Chris Joyce with New Scientist magazine. Billions and billions. Our guest speaker is probably one of the few people in public life who can be immediately and universally identified by a number. On one level, Dr. Carl Sagan has become the Mr. Rogers of astronomy. With his clear speaking style, he has made complex theories of the universe so understandable for the average public television viewer that he has become a cult hero. Instead of football, workers gathered around the water cooler have actually been heard discussing Uranus and black holes on mornings after his show. On another level, Dr. Sagan is a serious astronomer. He is the David Duncan Professor of Astronomy and Space Sciences and the Director for Planetary Studies at Cornell University. He has played a leading role in the Mariner, Viking, and Voyager expeditions to the planets, for which he received the NASA Medal for Exceptional Scientific Achievement, among the many other national and international awards he has received. His scientific research has enhanced our understanding of the greenhouse effect on Venus, dust storms on Mars, the organic haze on Titan, the origin of life on Earth, and the search for life elsewhere. Contrary to popular stereotypes about physicists and mathematicians, Dr. Sagan is a man of words as well as of numbers. He has written more than 600 published scientific papers and popular articles, and is the author, co-author, or editor of more than 20 books, one of which, The Dragons of Eden, won for him the Pulitzer Prize. And on still a third level, Dr. Sagan is a public advocate. In the early 1960s, his concern about transmitting Earth germs to the moon in unsterilized rockets led to the United States and the Soviet Union setting up standards for sterilizing space vehicles to prevent biological contamination. More recently, research that he and his colleagues have done on the long-term effects of nuclear war have made nuclear winter a household word and have put a crack into international defense planning. He is president of the 100,000-member Planetary Society, the largest space interest group in the world, and he is now, as he will tell us today, a major advocate of a joint U.S.-Soviet expedition to Mars. At the same time, he is publicly battling the concept of Star Wars and its huge drain on national research spending. Dr. Sagan, our audience here in this room, listening on National Public Radio and watching on C-SPAN, may not reach billions and billions, but certainly the thousands and thousands of us are waiting to hear what you have to say. Dr. Carl Sagan.
Thank you for that generous introduction. I'm delighted to be here with you. I have 20 minutes in which I want to talk about two or three very serious questions, and then I'll be delighted to answer questions on them or anything else on your mind in the question period. In the last few thousand years, human beings have devised an extraordinary set of technological advances which have enhanced our lives, have helped to diminish disease and increase well-being, although there's a great deal more work to be done. But at the same time, that technology has developed weapons of increasing sophistication and power to such an extent that we have now reached the extraordinary moment where our global civilization and perhaps the human species itself is in peril because of the possible misuse of this technology. For me, the dual content of technology is very clear, because the same technology that I am involved with in the spacecraft exploration of the planets, rocket technology, nuclear technology, electronics, computer technology, is also the very same technology that is used to devise and produce weapons of horrendous, grotesque, destructive power, of which we have amassed, we humans, some 60,000. 60,000 nuclear weapons, almost 30,000 so-called strategic weapons waiting for the orders to be launched halfway across the planet. Even a tiny fraction of these weapons could produce a catastrophe absolutely unparalleled in the history of human beings. For example, how many cities do you think there are on the planet Earth? If we define a city as having 100,000 people or more, there are only 2,300 cities on the Earth. That means that the United States and the Soviet Union, if they so wished, could, targeting two nuclear weapons per city, destroy every city on Earth and have almost 20,000 strategic nuclear weapons left over, to say nothing of almost 40,000 so-called tactical nuclear weapons. This is clearly madness. There is no need for these weapons. They serve no conceivable military purpose. If the function of a nuclear weapon is to discourage a potential adversary from using his nuclear weapons, a tiny fraction of the existing arsenals would suffice. We live in the year of Chernobyl and Challenger. These are high technology, high visibility projects of the Soviet Union and the United States, in which enormous amounts of national prestige have been invested. They are the last things you would imagine would go wrong in those societies, because they have so much to lose if something does go wrong. And there were confident estimates, some only a year before the catastrophes, about how improbable such catastrophes would be. An article in Soviet Life quoted authoritatively a Soviet deputy minister talking specifically about the Chernobyl reactor. It's a curious coincidence, saying that the average time you would have to wait for a catastrophic accident at Chernobyl was tens of thousands of years. The next year, boom. NASA officials were widely quoted as saying that at the then current launch rate of the space shuttle, you would have to wait 10,000 years or more before there was an explosion on launch. Boom. The lesson is that despite our best intentions, we can make serious technological mistakes. We also know many examples, consider the KAL-007 incident, that there are serious human mistakes that happen. This is also the century of Hitler and Stalin, and we realize that madmen can achieve high office in modern industrial states, or people can go mad while in office. If you put those together, the likelihood that the technology will go wrong if you wait long enough, the capacity of humans, it's part of our being human, to make errors, and the possibility of madness in high office. And you combine that with a world littered with 60,000 nuclear weapons, and you have a prescription for the most serious disaster that we have ever faced. And at the same time, almost everybody, at least in this country, goes on as if it's business as usual. No crisis, nothing to worry about. Occasionally, there are concerns. At the time the Reagan administration took office, there got to be a great deal of concern about the consequences of nuclear war, partly because of the activities of physicians' organizations indicating how inadequate American medical care, the best in the world, to be sure, would be in case of even a small nuclear war. In fact, the estimates of the number of people who would be killed outright in a major exchange between the United States and the Soviet Union range from hundreds of millions to a few billion people killed. And that's just from the direct consequences. And from the longer-term consequences, including radioactive fallout and climatic change, such as nuclear winter, the estimates are that another few billion people might be killed. Well, a few billion plus a few billion is getting very close to the total number of people on the planet. Now, it seems to me there are only two conceivable solutions to this problem. One is to reduce the arsenals so that in the worst case, the worst concatenation of technological failure, misunderstood orders, madness in high office, you could not destroy the global civilization. Massive bilateral verifiable divestment of nuclear weapons. And this is, of course, the proclaimed stated policy of the United States and the Soviet Union. The only trouble is every year those two countries add to their strategic arsenals enough weapons to destroy, once again, every city on the planet. They talk a good game. The other possibility is a defense, something that would protect you with high reliability, protect the civilian population of your country in case of the worst happening. And this is Star Wars. And Star Wars has, it must be acknowledged, a major political objective, that is to calm people's justifiable fears about nuclear war. There are many things that can be said about Star Wars. For example, I had a debate with General Abramson at the State Department in late July on this issue, but I would like to, there's so many things wrong with it, you can talk for hours just listing the dangerousness and foolishness of Star Wars. But let me give a few examples. One has to do with porosity. In the best case, if we spend $1 trillion or $2 trillion, if we have decades of technological development, how many Soviet warheads would get through? And the answer, according to advocates of Star Wars, in the Department of Defense, for example, that technologically competent people will give you some number of, oh, maybe 80%, maybe 90%, something like that. Suppose it's 90%. 90% of Soviet warheads can be shot down reliably. That means, of course, that 10% don't get shot down. The Soviet Union right now has well over 10,000 strategic warheads. If you let 10% of them get through, that's 1,000 warheads. 1,000 warheads is enough to destroy the United States utterly. So by the testimony of the program's advocates, it cannot protect the civilian population of the United States, which was, you remember, the objective in the president's speech where he talked about making nuclear weapons impotent and obsolete. But since then, there's been a change, what Senator Gore of Tennessee calls bait and switch. And now it's justified, well, it'll defend missile silos or it'll confuse the Soviets. That's a very different story. The Soviets can, of course, add to their strategic offensive forces to overwhelm whatever the United States, at great expense, manages to do in the way of defense. The Soviets can outfox by decoys and penetration aids. They can underfly the system because it does nothing for a low altitude or a speedboat delivery system or a cruise missile delivery system or nuclear weapons in small airplanes. I remind you that the small airplanes filled with bales of marijuana penetrate the United States every day ad libitum. And it is ruinously expensive. $1 trillion is half the national debt. $1 trillion is twice the total indebtedness of all third world nations to all Western banks. $1 trillion is too much to take casually. You have to get your money's worth for $1 trillion. And finally, Star Wars has the problem that the Soviets perceive it, the more generous of them, as economic warfare, the less generous of them as token of U.S. intent to do a first strike on the Soviet Union. They recognize that it cannot protect the civilian population of the United States, but if the U.S. made a massive first strike on the Soviet Union, Star Wars might be enough to mop up the residual Soviet forces that might be used for retaliation. So Star Wars cannot protect the civilian population of the United States, can be overwhelmed, underflown, outfoxed, is ruinously expensive, and is likely to increase the chances of nuclear war. Except for that, it's a terrific idea. What we really should be doing, the first thing on the agenda, the thing that's most clear, because it has the largest leverage on the nuclear arms race, is a treaty banning further tests of nuclear weapons. In 1963, the United States unilaterally stopped testing nuclear weapons above ground. The Soviet Union immediately responded with its own unilateral moratorium, just by accident. It was a coincidence, same week. And this de facto moratorium became a de jure treaty, the 1963 Limited Test Ban Treaty. And from that time to this, not a single US or Soviet nuclear weapon has been exploded on the ground, in the air, or in space. On August 6th, 1985, the 40th anniversary of the bombing of Hiroshima, the Soviets announced a unilateral moratorium on underground nuclear testing and invited the United States to follow suit. The US response has been to explode 20 nuclear weapons and to contemptuously reject the Soviet invitation. It is a very good way to halt the further escalation of the arms race. It's not enough in itself. We want to decrease the arsenals. But it's an excellent first step to defuse the technological drivers of the arms race on both sides. It is clear that the Soviet leadership is under pressure from their own hardliners. The offer will not remain open forever. Present expiration date is New Year's Day. And I think there is an urgent necessity for the United States to follow suit. This is clearly indicated in public opinion polls. Both houses of Congress have urged that the United States join the Soviets in this, and many mainstream groups are supporting it. Just as an example, just in a few days, Annie and I will be there, a venerable organization, the American Public Health Association, meeting in Las Vegas, is going to have a massive demonstration at the Nevada nuclear test site on September 30th to protest continued nuclear testing by the United States, to urge the United States to come to its senses, and there is every indication that there will be massive civil disobedience. That means crossing a white line and getting arrested for trespassing, by very respectable physicians and health professionals and others. And I give this to you just as one example of the recognition of the seriousness of this issue by almost everybody but the Reagan administration. I'd like now to come to my last topic. And again, it's this bifurcation that the technology implies. We have vast abilities. There is an extraordinary amount that we can do. The US space program is in deep trouble. It has lost a sense of purpose, which in fact it lost shortly after the Apollo program. And since then, it's merely been, let's develop machines, a shuttle, a space station, never what they're for. And in particular, the exploratory goal, which was the triumph of the Apollo era, has been completely lost from the US space program. At the same time, the European Space Agency and the Japanese and the Soviets have had gradually increasing sophistication and vigor in their programs. Something that to me makes an enormous amount of sense is a joint US-Soviet manned and womaned mission to Mars as part of a long-term program. The science would be extraordinary. Mars is a world of wonders. I will not take the time to describe it, but it is a just fascinating place. A billion years ago, water was flowing on Mars. There were rivers and lakes and possibly oceans. Something happened between then and now, and it might be good for us to discover what. But I don't think that you can justify sending humans to Mars purely for the science. You can send robots, and they're a whole lot cheaper. But just as Apollo was primarily a political program, it was the US response to the Bay of Pigs debacle and the fact that the first people to orbit the Earth happened to carry Soviet passports, so now also such a program could only be justified by political grounds. But the story has changed. It is not competition but cooperation which is called for now. And a joint Soviet-American program could capture the imagination of people all over the planet to show that these two nations could use that high technology on behalf, for a change, of the human species and to blaze a pathway into the third millennium, eventually making the human species a multi-planet species. The cost looks to be less than the Apollo program, vastly less than Star Wars, roughly the same as a single major strategic weapons system. It is as if God said to us, I set before you two choices. You have the technology to destroy yourselves. You have the technology to carry yourselves to the planets and the stars. It's up to you. Thank you.
You can imagine we have questions on a wide variety of topics today, Dr. Sagan. This first questioner would like to know, why do you not support the impetus which the Strategic Defense Initiative has given to basic research in the fields of laser, nuclear, and space technology?
Thanks. Because that argument is basically flawed. In the case of Apollo, for example, we heard that listen, Apollo is really great because of spin-off. That's what we're hearing here, spin-off. For example, because of the Apollo program, we have stickless frying pans or cardiac pacemakers. Well, if we want to have stickless frying pans or cardiac pacemakers, we can get them directly by investing in stickless frying pans and cardiac pacemakers without spending $25 billion to send some people to the moon. That's not the way you make a pacemaker. And in just the same way, if we are interested in lasers for surgery, we should develop lasers for surgery and not go via the route of a hydrogen bomb exploded in space to shoot down some foreign missiles in violation of about four different treaties the United States has solemnly signed. I forgot to say that before. The spin-off arguments are an indication that the other arguments have been found wanting. And I don't think for a moment we ought to be bamboozled by spin-off arguments. It's too much money. $1 trillion for laser surgery. You can do laser surgery for the tiniest fraction of that if that's what you're after.
France, through a United Nations initiative, has proposed the establishment of an international remote sensing agency, which would serve to provide total global reconnaissance so every country would be able to observe every other country totally. Would you be in favor of such an activity?
Thank you. There are many advantages of the space program. Meteorological satellites, which save enormous amounts of money in avoiding crop damage. Communication satellites, which are binding up the planet. A historic revolution occurs because of communication satellites. Scientific satellites, which it will be no surprise to you that I think is a good thing. But by far, the most important kinds of satellites have been military reconnaissance satellites. This is why I'm not opposed to military activities in space. It's only weapons in space I'm opposed to. Military reconnaissance satellites prevent the hotheads and paranoids on each side from thinking the worst of the other. It's a way to see what the other side is actually doing in terms of military capability and troop movements and treaty compliance and all the rest. And so it is enormously stabilizing. And that's why Lyndon Johnson said that those satellites were worth their weight in gold. And they are. And by the way, that is one of the many reasons why the Challenger disaster is a disaster in many senses. The U.S. has an important KH-11 and KH-12 satellite technology, which can't be put up into space because we don't have the booster. And at the same time, the United States does its share of saber rattling all around the world. Very dangerous to do that without having the optimum satellite reconnaissance. Now, if the monopoly in satellite military reconnaissance is held by only two nations, and they are the contending superpowers, there is a clear danger that they will, in public utterances at least, distort what they see for domestic or foreign political purpose. If they were an independent organization, some other nation which didn't have a political axe to grind, if you can find one, or some international organization, then this possible misuse of satellite reconnaissance capability could be avoided. But more than that, the rest of the world could be clued in to what is actually happening by the United States and the Soviet Union. And the French SPOT satellite, for example, was recently used to see what is the state of Soviet preparations for resuming nuclear testing if the United States does not reply, except by exploding more nuclear weapons. So to make a long answer short, I think it's a very desirable thing to involve other countries, just as it's very desirable to involve other countries in verification of, for example, compliance with claimed moratoriums on nuclear weapons testing. The Natural Resources Defense Council, a Washington-based public service organization, has an arrangement right now with the Soviet Academy of Sciences in which American scientists and seismometers are at the Soviet nuclear test facility at Semipalatinsk, monitoring the Soviets. They don't monitor any Soviet explosions, just American explosions. That is an example of a private organization helping in this way. The heads of state or government of India, Sweden, and four other countries have said they would be glad to take over the monitoring on both sides of compliance with a comprehensive test ban treaty, and I think that's a good idea.
This questioner notes that opponents of the joint U.S.-Soviet Mars mission fear the Soviets would use it to steal American technology and then use it for weapons. Would you give us your reaction to that, please?
Well, or the other way around. Maybe the Americans would steal Soviet technology and use it for weapons. What you have to bear in mind is that in this sort of planetary exploration space technology, the Soviets are very good. The Soviets were the first to land a spacecraft on the moon. They were the first to photograph the backside of the moon. They were the first to land working spacecraft on the surface of Venus. That's a tough place. Venus has a surface temperature of 900 degrees Fahrenheit. It has a surface pressure of 90 times the pressure in this room, and an atmosphere which contains hydrochloric acid, hydrofluoric acid, and sulfuric acid. Being the first to land a spacecraft there and take pictures and all that is not easy. Remember the Soviets did sent two spacecraft to Halley's Comet just last March. The United States did not send anything because we couldn't afford it. By the way, how expensive was it? It was exactly as expensive as a single B-1 bomber, of which the United States is committed to buy 100. 99 evidently would have compromised national security. American scientists have prepared a report for the Office of Technology Assessment, have testified before the Senate Foreign Relations Committee on just this issue, and what they say is that the two countries have very near parity on this sort of issue. But even if there was some technology transfer in both directions, you have to look at what we get in exchange. And the idea of the United States and the Soviet Union getting some practice in working together on high technological systems before the cameras, the television cameras of the planet is worth a great deal. Just picture it for a moment. The interplanetary spacecraft is constructed in Earth orbit. Little astronauts and cosmonauts are welding, moving girders, building stuff together. And it's all on television over a period of a year or two. Then they board the spacecraft, again televised. They take off for Mars. It's some 9 months journey. They orbit Mars. They then get into a descent module. They land on the surface of Mars, Americans and Soviets together on behalf of the human species. Again, the television cameras show this happening. They then explore Mars. They go on, let's say, some wheeled vehicle down an ancient riverbed looking for fossils in the banks or whatever there is there. They spend some time, months, let's say, on Mars. That's all before the television cameras. Then they come back to Earth with Mars samples, whatever wonders they have found. And that's all on television. Imagine such a sustained period of many years in which the United States and the Soviet Union together, maybe with Europeans and others, are doing something, a great adventure, great exploration, high scientific merit, together, and everyone on Earth sees it. That, it seems to me, is worth a great deal.
This questioner would like to know, why do you put such faith in U.S.-Soviet cooperation in a venture to Mars in today's climate of political distrust?
Distrust tends to be self-propagating. Distrust breeds distrust. There is no reason for the Soviets to trust us or for us to trust the Soviets on any issue except, I hope this is true, that each nation wishes to survive, that each nation wishes to have its people survive, and their children, and their grandchildren. There are very powerful human reasons why I think we can rely at least on that. And for that reason, doing things together, even small things, is well worth doing. Sigmund Freud said, a long time ago that it is shared action between nations that leads to the diminishment of mistrust. The United States and the Soviet Union each have a list of abuses by the other as long as my arm. You ask for the justification of any abuse that one of those countries does, and they'll tell you about an abuse that the other country does. But this is a treadmill. There's no way of getting off this unless you're willing to break out. This is a way of breaking out without compromising national security, without involving anything to do with nuclear weapons. It could be done, for example, in parallel with whatever divestment of nuclear weapons I sincerely hope the two countries would be done. It also has the right time scale in order to make a useful goal for the National Space Program. It is not so far in the future as to be impossible to do in the lifetimes of people working now. And it's not so short term as not to focus the program. It's exactly at the right technological distance, in just the same way that Apollo was the right technological distance in 1961 when President Kennedy asked for an American to be landed on the moon and brought back safely by the end of the decade. And by all standards, present studies suggest that the technological leap from President Kennedy's speech to Apollo 11 is less than the technological distance from today to a landing of humans on Mars.
You referred to the importance of television coverage of all events attendant to that. And since you are before an audience of journalists, this questioner would like to have you grade the savvy and accuracy of science, technology, and space reporting in the United States today and compare that to the reporting that you see in other countries.
Who? What shall I say? There's some good in this, a whole lot bad. One complaint I have is that science has a kind of panache, which is used to cover other stuff. On television, you see people who are called science reporters, but they're not science reporters. They're medical reporters. They're technology reporters. They're not science reporters. When people win Nobel Prizes in chemistry or physics, how many times have you gotten a coherent explanation of what they won their prize for? Just some guy, I was really surprised they woke me up in the middle of the night. My wife said she didn't believe it. Yeah, I'll be glad to go to Stockholm. What was it for? We never hear. The virtually every newspaper in America has a daily astrology column. A daily astrology column. Astrology is, of course, a hoax. There's no such thing. All tests show it doesn't work. It's been known for hundreds of years. Why do we have astrology columns? Those newspapers don't have a weekly astronomy column, by and large. How is that? How many major American newspapers have one science correspondent, never mind a science bureau? One person whose job it is to do science, never mind technology, never mind medicine, those are important. I'm talking about science. You have pages and pages of stock reports, minuscule, quantitative information, pages after page. Does everybody understand how to read it? No, but it's considered that there is a subset of the readership of the newspaper for whom that's important. Newspaper feels it has an obligation to provide for that subset. You look at the sports pages, box scores, WB, RBI, SO. What's that? If you're not a baseball fan, you don't know. You pass that by. But there's enough people who are interested that the newspaper considers it its obligation to show that detailed quantitative information. Where is the page which gives the detailed science information? Where is the page that encourages youngsters to think about it, that shows them they can understand it? The mere appearance of science in newspapers would say to kids, look, it's not too hard for you. It's in the newspaper. Everybody knows newspaper isn't hard. I must be able to understand this. It must be okay, science. See, I think there is a vast underestimation of the intelligence and curiosity of the American people. When we did our Cosmos television series, constantly had that that happen. And just recently, it's been Annie and I and some others redid it, something called Cosmos, a special edition. And again, we're getting people, I mean, ordinary people, not fancy academics, truck drivers, hairdressers, taxi drivers, saying to us, oh, I wish there was more of that on television. That's what I'd like. I learned something. The first time in months, I learned something from television. Or people say, often, but by no means always, women say, I had always thought I was too dumb to understand science. Your program showed me I could understand it. It gave them a self-confidence, a feeling that they could go further. Lots of people went further because of Cosmos. I think in television, in magazines, in newspapers, in radio, much more could be done to convey science to the average person. And it's important. It's important, first of all, because we are a scientific species. I mean, we're the only species on the planet that does science. It's intrinsic to us. We're curious. We want to find out. But also, as I tried to say in my talk, understanding science is central to solving the very serious technological problems which face us. How can we challenge clear, false statements by one government or another if we don't understand the underlying technology? It's not harder. The technology you have to understand the nuclear arms race, to understand Star Wars, to understand any of these issues, is not more difficult than what you have to understand to follow the sports pages. And I believe there is a real obligation to get that information to the American people. Our lives may depend on it.
Dr. Sagan, what do you think it might take to get newspaper editors to devote more space and energy to covering science?
A reasoned argument? Divine intervention? Somewhere in between those two.
That's actually a good transition to this next question. This person would like to know, why should not creation science be treated equally with evolution in our classrooms?
Because there is no such thing as creation science. Evolution is the backbone of modern biology. You cannot understand the nature of the biological world without understanding evolution. I maintain that evolution is a fact, not a theory. Science uses the word theory in a way that's different from how it's used in everyday life. In everyday life, people say, oh, that's just a theory, meaning you invented it while putting on your slippers as you got out of the bed this morning. But in science, a theory is a very well-supported body of knowledge. There's the atomic theory, you know, that everything is made of atoms. People don't say, oh, it's only a theory. Evolution is a theory on that level. It is very clear that evolution happened. All you have to do is look at the record in the rocks. If you have an undisturbed sedimentary column, at the top are the beasts and vegetables, the fossils of the beasts and vegetables around now. As you go deeper down, you go further back into time, as is clearly indicated by radioactive dating, and you find fossils of animals and plants you don't know. Who are those guys? They're not around now. Also, down there, how come there's no cows? How come there's no people down there? It's just dinosaurs and trilobites? It's very clear. Down there, many of the plants and animals around today weren't around. They hadn't come into being yet. Up here, those guys, those dinosaurs and trilobites, they're not around anymore. They've all become extinct. Life evolves. Now, that doesn't say that when I say evolution is a fact, that's not the same as saying that the mechanism of evolution is a fact. There is still significant debate on, for example, the extent to which natural selection explains everything, or in which cosmic disasters have changed things, and so on. But I think evolution is absolutely clear cut, and of all the nations on the planet, this is about the only one in which it's a serious issue. And it's a serious issue for emotional reasons, that is, a lot of people who don't want to be considered an animal I'm sorry. I'll be glad not to call you an animal if it offends you. But we are animals. We have evolved, and it's very important self-knowledge. And then, of course, the problem, the main reason is that there are people whose belief in the literal truth of every jot and tittle in the book of Genesis is offended by evolution. But the book of Genesis, I must say, is not literally true. It has problems. It has internal contradictions. Genesis chapter 1 contradicts Genesis chapter 2, just to start at the beginning. The Bible clearly implies that the earth is flat. It talks about the four corners of the earth in many places. Remember, you remember the time that Satan takes Jesus to a high mountain to offer him all the kingdoms of the earth. From that high mountain, you can see all the kingdoms of the earth, only if it's a flat earth. If the earth is round, you can't see the kingdoms on the other side. At least Satan thought that the earth was flat, and nothing that the author of that section of the Bible wrote contradicts it. The Bible is a great literary document, it's a great historical document, it's a great ethical and moral document, but it is not a scientific document. And I think that is something which is clear and ought to be taught. And creation science, so-called, is merely an attempt to introduce, contrary to the clear intent of the First Amendment, and I certainly share your fondness for it, of a particular particular religious viewpoint imposed on the educational system in the United States. Not only would I like to see First Amendment lounges, I'd like to see the whole United States declared a First Amendment zone.
Dr. Sagan, this questioner asks, do you believe there may be more to be learned in our inner space, namely our oceans, rather than in outer space? I don't like to compare the two, this questioner says, but would you like to give us your thoughts?
Well, there's a lot more up there than down here, but there's no question that the remaining major unexplored area on this planet are the oceans. They have great economic importance, great scientific importance, and very nicely, there is a range of submersibles now. Maybe you remember the vehicles exploring the Titanic, which are opening up a whole new generation of undersea science, and I'm all for it. By the way, this is not the only place with an ocean. Titan, the big moon of Saturn, looks to have an ocean of liquid hydrocarbons, and it'd be nice to explore that too. And if OPEC gets out of hand, there's an economic possibility, although the freightage will be high.
This questioner would like to know, what will be the fallout of the split in the scientific community, especially at universities, on the merits of Star Wars?
Thanks. There were so many things to say about Star Wars, I didn't have a chance to mention this. It's not just academic community, it's also industry. You wave $1 trillion at the U.S. aerospace community and academia, and you are going to find, no matter what the merits of Star Wars are, a whole lot of people sign up. And what is more, there is a danger that you will produce a kind of technological momentum, all just to keep making money and perquisites of power and promotions and stock options and all of that, that you can't turn off. The political power of an already politically sophisticated industry that is devoted to maintain what one flag officer described the feeding frenzy can be enormous. I am very proud of the academic community that so many scientists who could have been supported by Star Wars have signed a pledge. I've forgotten how many people. It's something over 8,000, I believe, top-ranking academics from the best physics departments in the United States, saying that they will not accept any support to work on Star Wars. But of course, lots do, because they have mouths to feed, they have families, they have mortgages. And every time that happens, someone is taken out of the civilian economy, out of working on pure science, out of working on things which will maintain the economic position of the United States in the world, and into something which has virtually no economic value. The dollars put into Star Wars are much less efficient in stimulating the economy than dollars put into domestic technology. Or even pure science.
Dr. Sagan, what is your reaction to NASA's canceling some 11 major scientific missions that were to fly on the space shuttle? Should the private sector get behind these missions financially, and should the academic sector formally protest in excess of military missions?
Well, when Challenger blew up and the shuttle program was put on hold, there were a superb set of scientific missions that were in the pipeline, ready to be launched by shuttle. There was, for example, dear to my heart, the Galileo spacecraft to Jupiter, first spacecraft to orbit a planet in the outer solar system, first spacecraft to send an entry probe into the atmosphere of Jupiter to, as it descends through the atmosphere, to examine what's there. A fantastic mission. Or the Hubble Space Telescope, by far the largest optical telescope ever put into Earth orbit, promises to revolutionize our knowledge of cosmology, the large-scale structure of the universe, information on the origin and fate of the universe, search for other planetary systems, most extraordinary expected harvest. All that's just sitting around. The cost of maintaining the Hubble Space Telescope is something like $1 million a day just to maintain it. And where does this money come from? Where does the money come from to maintain the scientific and technological teams who will be needed later on to launch the thing to study the data that's sent back? So the loss to NASA is not merely the obvious human tragedy and the technological setbacks and the money needed to replace a shuttle, if that's what we're doing. But these subsidiary effects, which are extremely serious. I don't think there's any chance that private industry will put up the hundreds of millions to billions of dollars for pure scientific satellites. Private industry is in the making money business, and you can't make money, just knowledge, which of course leads to money on a longer time scale, but industry is not interested in longer timescales. No, the only way to solve this problem is to put more federal money into resuscitating NASA, which is in desperate trouble. There's a great demoralization. There is no goal or direction to NASA. Scientific and technological teams are breaking up. Scientists who I know are leaving the top-ranking technological institutions within NASA or that support NASA. And we have a real crisis which has the danger, at least in the middle term, of being irremediable. That is, if all those people leave and then we get somebody else in the White House who says, wait a minute, this is really very bad, we need NASA, the people to do it may not be so easily acquired. So I maintain there is a genuine crisis which can only be solved, A, by a larger NASA budget, and B, and almost more important, a coherent sense of the national goal in space of the United States. I will do so.
This next question is apparently from one of your television fans. This person wants to know, assuming that the universe is expanding, does that imply that it is finite? And if it is finite, what is beyond?
Great question. I can best answer by an analogy. Consider a sphere, and in the way this is often described, a balloon. And that's to represent the universe. But it's a two-dimensional universe. That is, it's just the surface of the balloon, which is the universe, let's say. And on that surface, there are flat, two-dimensional things, flat galaxies, flat stars, flat planets, flat astronomers. Now, consider that universe. Is it finite? Sure. There's only so many square inches or centimeters on its surface. But what's on the other side? There isn't any other side. The surface is all there is. You go around and you come back to where you started from. Now you'll say, oh, well, wait a minute, there's a whole lot of space inside and outside. But that's in that third dimension that those flat guys can't get to. Now up everything one dimension and you have a kind of sense of what the answer is to the question. The universe can be, in Einstein's words, finite but unbounded.
I think you now have part of the answer of why there isn't more science reporting in newspapers.
if that wasn't clear, then that's my fault, not your fault.
This questioner would like to know, why should we want to establish colonies in space anyway?
Well, colonies in space covers a multitude of ideas, some of which I don't think are good ideas. For example, the idea of a large self-sustaining human community in Earth orbit, which could be done. By the way, could not conceivably solve any population problems every day on the planet. There's a few hundred thousand more people born than die, so you would have to launch a few hundred thousand people every day just to keep the population at a constant rate, and you will recognize that even when NASA was doing well, this was beyond its capabilities. There are some people who think it would be a good idea to have self-sustaining communities of human beings on other planets, so if the worst happened here, that at least there would be humans somewhere. I don't think that's a good idea either, because I think it would just a little bit add to the sense that, oh, the worst isn't really the worst. But in the long term, after solving our problems here, the idea of humans moving out into the space frontier after the Earth is all explored appeals emotionally to a whole lot of people, not to everybody. James Van Allen has described this as a kind of religion in which a lot of people feel it, but they can't tell you what the justification for it is. But we are an exploratory species. Remember, we come from hundreds of thousands of years of hunter-gatherer ancestors, people who roamed, nomads. That's who we are. And I believe in our genes somewhere that urge is there. The Earth is all explored, except for the ocean bottoms that a previous questioner asked about. It's natural to look out to the planets to do this. And I gave before some political reasons why I think it would be good to do United States and Soviet Union together, but I recognize that not everybody might find this last in the genes argument a compelling argument. Still, a lot of people feel it.
Dr. Sagan, as usual, we have way more intriguing questions than we have time today. Before I ask the last question, let me present you with our Certificate of Appreciation for being here today and a National Press Club paperweight, which can weigh down your newest theories, I guess. The last question that I have is from someone who would like to know, when can we expect to spot Sagan's comet?
Well, I'm not sure what that is. Annie and I wrote a book called Comet, and since I'm very unlikely to discover a comet, I guess that's more properly called Sagan-Drian's comet is the only one I'm likely to have, and that's out in hardback right now. It'll be out in paperback in November.
Thank you. even remember her son.
I think Rich is in the same room.
Which of them?